Japanese fishermen in Fukushima Prefecture are marking a first. They're hauling in white bait, something they haven't done since the nuclear accident in March 2011. They say their catch is safe. Dozens of boats came back to a port in the city of Soma. The fishermen were busy unloading, but seemed happy. They decided to resume catching white bait after tests showed that hardly any radioactive substances have been detected in the fish.
We are so glad that we can fish for white bait again.
The fishermen tested their catch twice before and after boiling and processing. They confirmed the radiation readings were far below the safety standard. They plan to sell the white bait at local markets and at Tokyo's Tsukiji market.
The Japanese government held a nuclear disaster drill on Saturday. It's the first such emergency drill since the accident at the Fukushima Daiichi plant in 2011. About 130 organizations and 3,300 residents participated in the two-day exercise on Friday and Saturday. The drill was based on a scenario in which a major earthquake hits the Sendai nuclear plant in Kagoshima Prefecture, causing a loss of cooling functions for the number 2 reactor. Prime Minister Shinzo Abe and cabinet ministers took part in an exercise at the Prime Minister's official residence in Tokyo.
I declare a state of emergency based on the Act on Special Measures Concerning Nuclear Emergency Preparedness.
The order was based on government guidelines that were revised after the accident in Fukushima. The new guidelines state that people living within a 5-kilometer radius of a nuclear plant must immediately evacuate the area. The Prime Minister's residence was linked by video phone with the Kagoshima Prefectural Government to coordinate an emergency task force response. Residents near the plant began leaving their homes upon receiving the evacuation.
A nuclear nightmare would be nothing new for Japan. And now, for the first time since the Fukushima crisis, a major disaster drill is being held to see if lessons have been learned. More than 3,000 people have been taking part in the two-day exercise in Kagoshima Prefecture. Prime Minister Shinzo Abe even held a mock news conference in Tokyo, announcing a state of emergency. Under the scenario, an earthquake triggers an accident at a reactor and radioactive material starts leaking. Many participants were not given advance notice of how events would play out to test how they'd cope in a real-life situation. Japan has had to rethink its nuclear safety guidelines since the Fukushima plant was damaged by an earthquake and tsunami in 2011. Since then, operators TEPCO have struggled to contain leaking radiation.
Staff at a school in northern Japan have come up with a two-wheeled plan to keep their students safe from tsunami. Instead of heading to higher ground on foot or in a car, the students will get there by bike. Most students at this junior high school in the coastal city of Misawa commute by bicycle. During a mock tsunami drill, 44 of them started pedaling to higher ground, roughly 3 kilometers away. They got there in about 20 minutes. Staff originally thought it would take them twice that amount of time.
The good thing about a bicycle is that you can evacuate quickly. But I think it might be dangerous compared to walking or driving.
The school's principal says the students will continue practicing so they can learn to navigate bumpy roads safely.
It's a crisis that just keeps coming. Leaks of radioactive water from the troubled Fukushima Daiichi nuclear reactor have alarmed Japan's neighbors and cast a shadow over Prime Minister Shinzo Abe's can-do administration, which for once looks at a loss. Trade and Economics Minister Toshimitsu Motegi recently admitted that the government bears some, but not all, responsibility for the issue.
It is undeniable that the response to the contaminated water problem has been incoherent. The decommissioning and work of dealing with the contaminated water, the daily operation in other words, will have to be handled by the operator of the plant, Tokyo Electric, which has to have the actual responsibility.
So why this ambivalent approach? Well, first, the ruling Liberal Democratic Party has long promoted the use of nuclear power. And secondly, there's Abenomics. Abe has scored some successes in his drive to revitalize the economy, and he needs to keep the momentum going. Before the earthquake that sparked the Fukushima crisis, around 30% of Japan's electricity was generated by its nuclear reactors. But with most plants going idle since, the country's turned to imported fossil fuels. And the same weak yen that has cheered Japan's exporters has made those imported fuels a lot more expensive.
If the nuclear power plants aren't restarted as we go into the winter months, you're probably talking about 250,000 barrels of oil equivalent extra being required by Japan.
Despite the costs, many Japanese remain against putting the idle reactors back online. Take responsibility and put a stop to nuclear power. Don't pollute nature any more than you already have. The government wants to restart reactors in other areas. It's like starting a new battle at the end of World War II. Do they understand anything? So what are Abe's options? Independent providers say more electricity could be generated from gas and renewables if the government paved the way for smaller companies like Ennet to enter the heavily monopolized utility sector.
I think the key to Abenomics' success is whether or not he can pull off a concrete policy change. If customers had more of a choice in who their provider is, the competition between suppliers would lead to an increase in service, and more choices will appear.
So while Abe's been praised for his bold moves to boost growth, he will need to tackle even more ambitious reforms or risk seeing this crisis trickle further into the economy.
Japanese and Canadian leaders are joining hands to help keep Japan supplied with energy. They've agreed their countries will work together more closely to exploit Canada's reserves of natural gas in shale formations. Japan's Minister of Economy, Trade and Industry, Toshimitsu Motegi, sat down with Canada's Natural Resources Minister, Joe Oliver. They agreed to have gas development projects in Western Canada start shipping to Japan. And Motegi promised financial help to build facilities to liquefy the natural gas and ports to ship it.
I have high hopes for the competitive supply of LNG from Canada, one of Japan's closest and long-term allies. The LNG imports from Canada will enhance the bilateral relationship between Japan and Canada.
Japanese firms have rights to 8.6 million tons of Western Canada's liquefied natural gas a year. That's equivalent to one-tenth of Japan's annual imports. Japan currently gets most of its LNG from the Middle East.
Japan's foreign minister says his country will sign a UN statement calling for a ban on the use of nuclear weapons. Japanese officials refused to sign a similar document earlier this year. New Zealand, Switzerland and 14 other countries are leading UN efforts to release the joint statement later this month.
I'm announcing that Japan is going to endorse the statement. As the world's only victim of atomic bombings, our country understands the misery that nuclear weapons bring about.
Foreign Minister Fumio Kishida said Japan has a moral responsibility to work continuously to rid the world of nuclear weapons. In April, Japan refused to sign a document containing similar language at a conference on the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. The April statement said nuclear arms should not be used under any circumstances. Japanese officials said they refused to sign it since the country relies on the U.S. nuclear umbrella. Kishida was asked about the change in the government's stance. He said he personally asked New Zealand's foreign minister to adjust the wording in the latest statement.
The United States and Vietnam have signed a deal allowing the transfer of nuclear technology to the Asian nation. Vietnam's nuclear industry is expected to grow to $50 billion by 2030. U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry inked the deal with Vietnamese Foreign Minister Pham Binh Minh after they met on the sidelines of the East Asia Summit. The two officials pledged that U.S. technology will not be used by Vietnam to develop nuclear weapons. The Vietnamese minister also promised that his country will not enrich or reprocess nuclear fuel. President Barack Obama must add his signature and the U.S. Congress give its approval for the deal to take effect. Russia and Japan were the successful bidders for Vietnam's first and second nuclear power plants. More nuclear facilities are planned in the country.
Investigation into the authenticity of parts used at nuclear power plants around the country has unearthed numerous cases of fraudulent safety certificates. Nearly 280 quality certificates were confirmed to have been forged. Our Han Daeun has more on the findings.
The Office for Government Policy Coordination on Thursday announced the results of its probe into a nuclear power plant scandal over forged documents on Thursday. Minister of the OPC Kim Dong-yeon says an investigation into the nation's 20 operating nuclear plants found that nearly 280 quality certificates were forged.
277 quality certificates were confirmed to have been fabricated, and most of the 7,730 parts installed under those documents have either been replaced or have completed a recertifying process.
Regarding a yet-to-be-completed probe on five plants currently being built and three plants that were shut down this summer, Kim said more than 2,000 safety documents were confirmed to have been fabricated. The government has indicted some 100 people involved in the scandal so far on charges of document fabrication. The list includes suppliers and certification officials. The former president of Korea Hydro and Nuclear Power Corporation and the vice president of the Korea Electric Power Corporation were also indicted on charges of taking bribes. Minister Kim added, however, none of the plant breakdowns reported over the last 10 years were related to the parts supplied under forged documents. The government has also laid out anti-corruption measures for the nation's nuclear plant industry. The measures include regulating personal exchanges between public officials and suppliers and improving transparency within the current purchasing system. Han Daeun, Arirang News.
Monday, 10 of the government shutdown, and today thousands more were sent home. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission, or NRC, monitors 100 plants nationwide, including the power plant in Clinton. Today, more than 3,000 employees were furloughed. These are people that Clinton plant employees call for questions. Now, no one was sent home from here, Clinton, you're looking at it, but if there is an issue that's a non-emergency, it will have to wait until after the shutdown.
State leaders are running out of patience with the pace of the Hanford cleanup.
U.S. Department of Energy officials say they are now at risk of missing three more deadlines. Environmental specialist Gary Chittum has been covering the Hanford beat now for more than a decade and joins us now with how the state is reacting to this latest announcement.
Well, Laurie and Dennis, as you might expect, not happy about this one bit. Attorney General Bob Ferguson said he is troubled by all the delays and excuses. He's already working on possible legal action following more of the same.
The once high expectations for the Hanford Waste Treatment Plant have been grounded in disappointment. The plant, designed to convert Hanford's 56 million gallons of deadly nuclear waste into stable glass, is way behind schedule and billions with a B over budget. And now, the Department of Energy says it's at risk of expanding its list of missed deadlines at the plant from 11 to 14.
And these aren't just, it's just sort of informal deadlines. These are deadlines entered into with the federal court. The federal government has an obligation to meet those deadlines, and they continue to miss them.
The three new deadlines at risk involve the plant's low-level waste treatment facility, which was supposed to go online in 2019. Plant contractors have said it's difficult to design a plant to treat waste that contains unknown elements of nuclear and chemical compounds.
Let me just put it this way, that I'm not terribly interested in the excuses, okay, just to be candid about it, right? They've got deadlines, and they're obligated to meet them.
This is why the delays at the plant are so worrisome. Waste has been and is still leaking from some of the 177 underground nuclear waste tanks in Hanford. The waste is extremely hot, and the tanks are extremely old. They need to drain those tanks before they fail, and to do that, they need the treatment plant. Time is running out.
You know, it's about the most important issue we've got facing us right now for the health and safety of the people of this state, for the environment of this state.
Okay, so now what is the state going to do about it? Ferguson won't say, says he can't, but he did say he is going to tell the governor, he may have already told the governor, what he thinks should be done. He's not ruling out legal action. The state has sued the feds over Hanford before, and actually the last time they did it, they got the agreement that the Department of Energy just violated this time.
Okay. All right, we'll wait and see.